In the English countryside, 90 miles west of London and 3 miles from the nearest railroad, rests a small town called Shaftesbury. It was considered quaint and picturesque even in the 1930s, when a town crier still walked up and down the streets, ringing a bell and delivering messages like, "Lost, a £5 note. Finder will be rewarded on returning it." Though the town remains charming and beautiful today, our story begins 2 centuries earlier. A family called the Upjohns had been living in Shaftesbury for generations. They originally came from Wales, and their name was an anglicized version of the Welsh Apjohn, or Apjohnus, which means son of John. James Upjohn was a surveyor, which involved mapping and valuing properties. His wife, Elivis Plantagenet Dryden Mitchell, gave birth to a first child in 1802, but died of a disease the same year. The son's name was Richard. Richard became fascinated by tools and drawing and began an apprenticeship to a cabinet maker when he was 17. The work gave him experience in mechanical drawing, visualizing and understanding objects in 3D space, and the limitations of tools and materials. His 5-year contract forbid gambling with master's property, going to taverns, acting promiscuously, and marrying, but soon after it ended, he became engaged to Elizabeth Perry. Although Richard was Anglican and Elizabeth the daughter of a dissenting minister, they married, had a son 2 years later, and would remain together for life. Richard made a living building furniture and doing roofing, flooring, and windows, but still had pressing financial difficulties. He wrote in a letter, "The want of a proper trust in divine providence, too much confidence in my own power, and too little knowledge of mankind, sent me floundering into difficulties in my native land." 2 years after he was married, he chose to leave the country with his wife and son, setting sail on a 6-week voyage to New York. Richard's journal of the trip includes some amusing and interesting entries. His 1-year-old son enjoyed the tossing about of the ship while everyone else on board got seasick. Richard argued with another passenger about universalism and wrote that it was somewhat productive of conviction in the person with whom I conversed. They saw 5 whales, bathed in the sea, and had a rowing match with 4 passengers racing against the captain and the first mate. The captain and first mate won, of course. As they approached Long Island, they were met with dense fog, lightning, and thunder. After a medical examination on Staten Island, they arrived in New York with $3 silver to spare. Years later, Richard would write to his children, "We walked up Broadway, your mother with pattens on her feet and a baby in her arms, and the first roof we went under was Trinity Church. And 10 years later, I put a new roof on it." They stayed with Elizabeth's brother in New York for a year before moving to the whaling town of New Bedford, Massachusetts, where Richard began working as a draftsman for Samuel Leonard, the wealthiest oil merchant of the time. Richard ran an evening drafting school at the same time and soon opened up his own office, with advertisements like, "Architectural plans and elevations neatly executed at short notice by Richard Upjohn. Orders left at the Mechanics Hall in New Bedford." Things picked up quickly. Richard designed a house in Bangor, Maine, made in the traditional Greek style of the day, then did another for the client's brother. He moved to Boston, began working for Alexander Paris, hired a lad for the office, and did commissions like the Boston City Hall. Richard gained his citizenship, and in 1835 began designing a $60,000 medieval mansion in Gardner, Maine. That's more than $1.5 million in modern money. Nathaniel Hawthorne, writer of The Scarlet Letter, called the Oakland's mansion splendid, and said it well deserves the name of castle or palace. But halfway through the project, financial catastrophe struck the country. It was the Panic of 1837, an economic depression that would see wages and profits plummet, while unemployment rose to 25% in some areas. Richard only received 5 commissions that year. On top of that, R.H. Gardner, the Oakland's mansion client, refused to pay Richard for the revisions he had been doing. Richard requested that Gardner at least pay him in apples and potatoes so that he could feed his now 7-person family. Richard would later contend that the revisions were because Gardner kept changing his mind constantly and had hired unqualified builders. Richard was eventually paid, but only at a fraction of normal rates. Thankfully, things took a turn when Richard became friends with Dr. Jonathan Wainwright, rector of Trinity Church in Boston. Church began hiring him for alterations of churches and chapels, including St. John's in Bangor, Maine. For this project, Richard's style moved from the curved arches of Georgian Gothic architecture to the pointed windows of what was known as Gothic Revival. In 1838, Dr. Wainwright accepted a call to fill a vacancy at an Episcopal parish in New York, Trinity Church. The first Trinity Church in New York had burned to the ground in 1776, and the second building was in grievous need of repairs. Despite iron braces put in, the roof was sagging after heavy snowstorms. Dr. Wainwright called in Richard for repairs and alterations, but it soon became evident that the walls were out of plumb, the tower was defective and insecure, and the entire building needed to be replaced. Plans were drawn up. A spire, 50 feet higher than the previous one. Buttresses, battlements, tracery. Everything would be stone. The aisles would have low enough ceiling to allow clerestory above. But here's where things get really interesting. As Richard was designing an Episcopal church, he was starting to incorporate architecture that was traditionally considered Roman Catholic. Instead of a shallow one-bay chancel, Richard argued for a deeper two-bay chancel that would put more emphasis on the sacraments at the front of the church. He eventually compromised by having a two-bay chancel that was divided by a partition wall to make the stage smaller. The church would later take down the wall, making it deep again. Richard also had strong opinions on how the spire should be topped. Many of the parishioners thought that a cross would be Catholic iconography and wanted a simple weather vane instead, like with the previous building. In response, Richard kept a cross at the ready, put it up as soon as the spire was completed, and immediately took down the scaffolding. By the time the parishioners saw what had happened, it was too late, and too expensive to change. Trinity Church was dedicated on the day of the Feast of Ascension, May 1st, 1846. It encouraged a shift towards medieval Gothic styles in church architecture, established Richard as a noteworthy architect, and was even featured in the greatest Nicolas Cage movie of all time, National Treasure.
Trinity Church. We have to go inside Trinity Church.
For retirement, Richard moved into a historical house in Garrison, New York. His daughter, Elizabeth Babcock, wrote that in his last days he said cheerfully to his physician, "Well, doctor, this body is about worn out. Isn't it about ready to be put aside? It has not been an idle body. It has worked hard for these many years. Is it not about done now?" And later, "This body must lie here, waiting patiently to be clothed with immortality." He blessed his firstborn son and architectural partner, Richard Mitchell Upjohn, and passed away at age 76 in 1878, finally going to meet the one whose houses he had been designing his whole life.